Now, we're going to bring to the stage Michael Fembeck and two of, I got to tell you, two of my favorite rock stars, Thorkil, SONNE and Frank HOFFMANN. These two gentlemen, we're all Ashoka fellows, so I have huge regard for these men. But these guys are going to be talking about taking solutions across borders with Michael. And I've got to tell you, this is going to be a super session, not just because I love these guys, because they're stories. So off you go, Thorkil and Frank and Michael.
Thank you, Caroline. Please, everyone, come on stage. I'm going to make the intro in the meantime. My name is Michael Fembeck. I'm the director of the Zero Project and very happy to chair this session. The topic is internationalization. As Caroline said already, we are happy to have two social entrepreneurs here having successful models in the field of employment of persons with disability, two very different ones. We're trying to develop here together what they have in common, what they are different, what they're working on, what are the biggest challenges, and I know them very well. We also, as the Zero Project and the Essl Foundation, support them in Austria. I know that they are very open and easy to talk to, and will be very openly discuss all the issues that they're having. On top of that, we also have on the stage the two ladies who run the Austrian branches of Discovering Hands and Specialisterne. So we have a kind of twofold or even threefold kind of discussion on internationalization. It's very difficult to say. So it's not only about Discovering Hands versus Specialisterne, it's also about what the international Discovering Hands and Specialisterne mission strategy is and how this is implemented in another country. So another interesting aspect that we want to develop on. And finally, we have also Anna Botero here with us on stage. Now we have her on stage. Anna Botero is, she will also introduce herself. She's a kind of hub, of development hub, from Latin America. She's much more able to explain this to herself later, but she's a kind incubator in Latin America, and she will add her experience in starting up projects that want to scale up or to replicate in a country. In this case, it's Latin America. So I'm going to stop here. I'm going to hand over to Frank and Thorkil, who have arranged between themselves how to start this session. They will have a kind of co-production on presenting the Discovering Hands and Specialisterne at the beginning of the session.
Hello, everybody. I'm very glad to be here at the Zero Project Conference once again. And I think, Thorkil, the same to you. We will share our experiences as social entrepreneurs, bringing a model which was set up in our home countries on its way to internationalization, having a short focus on our experiences here in Austria, the specific experiences, and then looking for components which are helpful to bring it to the world, more or less. Just a short business card, more or less. What is Discovering Hand doing? It's a German social enterprise, a non-for-profit enterprise, which started its activities in April 2014, even if we developed the program already in 2006. We started to develop the program. Blind and visually impaired women are trained as medical tactile examiners. They are giving assistance to medical doctors in the fight against breast cancer, performing high quality level examination of the female breast, which allows them to find the smaller lumps into the tissue. And this is really a big difference for the chance of healing breast cancer. It's a 9-month training program, and they are able to find lumps between 6 and 8 millimeters, where, as we doctors normally start to find lumps from 1 to 2 centimeter size. MTEs use these haptic orientation stripes to perform their examination. And the program is really a completely new field of profession for blind and visually impaired people. Now, Thorkil, I hand this over to you for your business card.
Thank you, Frank. It's great to be with you again. We met several times in different places in the world. I would like to talk about dandelions, because it's not about autism, it's not about specialists, it's really about dandelions. This may be the surprise of the day. But dandelions are loved by kids. They blow dandelions, they make wishes, they feed their rabbits with dandelion leaves. But as you grow older, something happens. And if you buy a house with a garden, you see the wonderful flower again. Probably the love has turned to hate. Now it's a weed. You used to love it, now you hate it. The flower is the same, but something changed. What changed is your norms have been replaced by society's norm. Because now you only want the flowers in your lawn and in your flower bed that you have decided upon, that fits into the ideal situation in the garden. But what is a weed? A weed is really a flower in an unwanted place. If you take it to the kitchen garden, treat it well, you'll find it's one of the most valuable plants in nature for nutrition, natural medicine, coffee, tea, wine, beer. And I met farmers who make a living out of growing dandelions. The message is that every dandelion has the same potential in it if it's seen as an herb. But for those who only see it as a weed, you'll never get access. So what we are trying to do is we are creating these welcoming flower beds, these small kitchen gardens in the labor markets, where also autistic people who today are very much rejected by recruiters because they don't fit the social expectations. We need them in the workplace. We need to form these small flower beds, kitchen gardens. Specialisterne is based on a vision of a world where people are given equal opportunities in the labor market. For autistic people, there may be on or unemployment rate of about 80%. We believe that by bringing autistic people into the workplace, we can create better work environments. We can reduce stress levels because you have to grow your management skills to work with autistic people. And actually, in today's Austrian newspaper, it says that there's a lot of stress in the labor market in Austria. 1/4 of every man is close to a breakdown, 1/5 of every woman. We believe that we, by including autistic people, can reduce stress levels in any labor market. The mission is to educate stakeholders in talent and career development for autistic people through innovation, collaboration, and knowledge sharing. This is also why we are here today. We've set a goal to enable 1 million jobs for autistic people. It's a big goal for a Dane with living in a 5.6 million citizen country, but that is why I relocated to the US and I'm working on the global scene right now. We started 13 years ago, and we have operational experiences from 15 countries in different cultures, in different welfare systems. We work with global partners. We are associated with the United Nations, Department of Public Information, and World Economic Forum. So it's a special treat to be here today with the Zero Project and with the UN. I'm helping the UN to organize annual events around the UN World Autism Awareness Day events.
Back to you. Thank you very much. Thorkil, you are 8 years ahead, but I'm pretty sure that Discovering Hands will follow you on this way of success, because we believe that the model we can deliver to the labor markets of the world and to the world of visually impaired people is a really win-win-win situation. On the one hand, we open a completely new profession for visually impaired people. They are making a capability out of a disability. And they are not even as good as doctors, they are much better. And this is meaningful for women suffering from breast cancer. And on the third side, it also saves money for the public purses, health insurances, and also the pension funds are saving money. And there's another very important aspect of the model. I think Anna will later on say something more to that. The overwhelming majority of visually impaired women are unemployed and often struggle with extreme poverty, especially in the countries which we call the developing countries. More than 90% of visually impaired women there are unemployed, and this is also a very meaningful aspect for this model. Even if blindness and breast cancer are global phenomena, the setting in the given countries of this world is very, very much differing when we try to implement the model. I think this is the same experience you made, and this is what we are talking later about, because we want to find the success factors in this process. But we have decided to bring the Discovery Hands model via a franchise, a social franchise system to the world, and we were already successful in finding first franchisee here in Austria. Supported by Essl Foundation and Sinnstifter, we were able to set up a pilot phase 2 years ago, and now on my side is Marisa MÜHLBÖCK, the CEO of Discovery Hands Austria. I'm very proud that we made this very important next step for the development of the model. On the other hand, we do have a first pilot project which was finished in August of the last year in Colombia with the support of CAF. I think also about that Anna will give some report to you. And we have started another pilot right now in India, and we have many, many contacts and first talks with other organizations, other people from other countries. So this process is, it's just early days for this process. We need always 5 steps to implement the model in another country. We have to find a local partner. We have to set up a local project team to run the pilot. This needs about 18 months, and each of these steps has to be set up very professionally and with much awareness. And the points Shira Ruderman, the elements Shira Ruderman pointed out in her presentation when she gave us her keynote in the morning, that you have to match expectations to perform transparency, that you have to define the common mission, is very important for these first 3 steps. After that, we will find a franchising organization which takes over responsibility for the scaling up in the given country, and then we close the franchise contract.
Autism is a global phenomenon. So I've been contacted by parents in maybe 100 countries from all over the world who have heard about what we're doing and have asked me to help. And being a parent of an autistic child, I cannot say no when parents make contact with me. I can say, be patient, we'll find a way. We've set a goal, 1 million jobs, and our expectation is that about 100,000 of those will be in North America, 100,000 in Latin America, 250,000 in Europe, 100,000 in Africa, Middle East, 200,000 India, 200,000 China, 50,000 in Asia Pacific. We are in five continents now, building our knowledge base. We have learned a lot about maturity of the different markets. On the supply side, on is autism recognized? Are there programs for autistic students? How is the autism community? How does the government support? And on the other axis, on the demand side, what is the need in the autism space or in the business space that autistic people can be a good fit for? Autistic people typically have a good memory, ability to see patterns. They have attention to detail. They can have a high accuracy in repetitive tasks, and they come up with new ways of finding solutions to old problems. Everyone are very different. Everyone is a story in itself. And one of our specialists and employees in Austria even today gave me a book about his story. Ich muss mich durch Leben tasten. And it's such a thrill to work with autistic people. They are honest, they are straightforward, they are without filters. You get what you see, you get very loyal people, and many of have the skills that are very much needed in the corporate space. But many have also gone through a life of vulnerability, and it's very important that we'll be able to set up a support structure. Getting a job is one thing, but then it should be a start of a career. So it's a long way, but we'll get there. We've been through an evolution the past 10 years. We have probably enabled about 1,000 jobs. We have experience from about 15 countries. Very much have been about individual placements in companies supported by Specialisterne. We've been promoting, there have been a lot of article, TV broadcast, books. So we have created quite a lot of awareness together with other players in the field. We have created these individual comfort zones. So in our dandelion philosophy, we have created some very small flower beds where autistic people thrive as herbs. Right now, we just come, Elisabeth and I, from a group meeting in Barcelona. For 4 days, we have been discussing what we learned, what patterns can we see, where are the challenges, what have we together developed of services, of products that we can go to the market with. How do we work with the education system? Because we have to develop the talent pipeline better than it's being done today. And it's so fantastic to have this feeling that we are not individual specialists in operations, even though some are in Brazil, some are in the US, in very different settings. We are one group that can benefit from the experiences and the programs in different countries. So right now it's company onboarding, very much in the English-speaking countries, like in Australia. We are doing cybersecurity work together with Hewlett Packard for the government. We are doing tasks for the government on border control and immigration. For Department of Human Services, we're doing software testing. And the recent business area we developed is pig farming. Many autistic people, they like to work with animals. So this is actually a good example of what other business areas that could be without beyond IT. It's very much business to business people who are satisfied with our services, make contact to their peers in other companies. So we are creating a lot of acceptance that, of course, autistic people have a role to play in the labor market. We have created these team comfort zones where we also teach employers, colleagues in the companies to understand how you communicate and manage the best possible way with autistic people. So we are at the greenhouse stage right now. We are working teams in companies. Over the next 10 years, we will reach the 1 million jobs globally. And we have to think of how can we mainstream our experiences so we can plug into the standard recruitment challenge from universities, colleges, and other education platforms. How can we help parents? How can we help autistic people grow the talent base and prepare for the labor market better? We need to tap into the grassroots organizations. In very many companies, there are employee resource groups. Microsoft talked about it earlier today. There are companies who have more than 1,000 members of their autism interest group in the companies, which means that that is actually an enormous knowledge base that is already in the companies that can be used to employ autistic people, and others can benefit from that. Then we have the autism organizations whose biggest hope is a job as a start of a career for their family members. So we need the grassroots to be engaged, and we need to go from having a job in spite of autism to having a job because of autism. We need to work with the governments. We need to work with the leaders in the local community to reach the 1 million job, where it will be more than of a field, a mainstream, where the benefits of the dandelions will reach all over in the community. With the UN, we are promoting Sustainable Development Goal number 8. The strategy to showcase with leading employers, globalize together with the global clients and partners, bring employment knowledge into the education system so we can remove the divide that is there today after graduation. We'll train local partners who can be trained, certified, operated through our intellectual property, and then do the local work in the local communities of education, assessment, and onboarding and retention. We need to document what works, what does not work, and scale through technology-based or web-based technology to remove the barriers that we face today, and then follow up on an annual celebration at the UN World Autism Awareness Day.
I will hand over the controller to Marisa. You said that you are not alone. The specialists and the teams are forming a kind of family. It's the same for Discovering Hands.
Thank you, Frank, and good afternoon, everybody. I have now the pleasure to give you an overview of the development of Discovering Hands in Austria. And I will start demonstrating this by splitting the progress we made into three parts or three phases. And at the same time, I will focus on four issues that best describe this development. First, the progress we made in implementing the business model. Second, I will talk about the number of training courses we accomplished, and third, the number of MTEs trained. And last but not least, I will show you how we were able to finance the activities we've done so far and how we consider to do so in the future. Phase one, from 2013 until the middle of 2015, can more or less be called the evaluation phase. The main question was, how does the model fit into the Austrian market? And at this point, the fact that Frank is an Ashoka fellow, was part of the International Ashoka Network. I don't know if everybody knows Ashoka is a platform for social entrepreneurs worldwide. That was very helpful. Ashoka representatives in Austria connected Frank to a group of philanthropists who agreed to finance the evaluation project. And furthermore, a pharmaceutical company, Boehringer Ingelheim, signed an employee as a pro bono project partner, or pro bono project manager, for discovering hands in Austria. And this person was not just anybody, but a highly skilled lady, and she was very well connected, especially among the healthcare community in Austria. And I guess this was quite a crucial factor for the success of the evaluation project at that point. And in the middle of 2015, the franchise contract was closed. During this initial phase, one train-the-trainer course was completed in Germany, and afterwards the first MTE training took place in Vienna, coordinated by our training partner Sibus, which is a training center for blind and visually impaired people in Austria. And we had four MTEs trained. As I said before, this phase was financed by a group of philanthropists called the Sinnstifter. And one of them is the Essl Foundation, which is of course known to everybody in this room. I already mentioned Boehringer Ingelheim and Ashoka as important pro bono partners. And Ashoka was coming up with the idea to present the project in one of our national startup TV shows, which Frank did. And he absolutely scored, which means he convinced one of Austria's well-known business angels and impact investors to invest in Discovering Hands. And this marked the beginning of phase two, the franchisee story. But shortly after closing the contract, one of our major obstacles became obvious, and this is the legal status in Austria. Why is this? Well, in comparison to Germany, doctors in Austria are not allowed to delegate services such as the examination of the female breast. And we have the same situation with almost any medical service, unless the person assigned is educated in the field of the so-called medical assistance professions. So this was what became our mission, to establish such a job description for medical tactile examiners for blind and visually impaired persons in Austria. And now, with the permission of the Ministry of Health, we are now conducting a study with the intention to prove that our medical tactile examiners find at least as many lumps in the tissue as doctors do. At this stage, we also enlarged our network and established strong partnerships with doctors and with health care facilities in Austria. And we also managed to start a second MTE course and increase the number of trained MTEs to six. The financial situation at this stage was secured by impact investment. Phase three, let's take a look into the future. As I said, we are now conducting a study and we hope to get this milestone done in this year, followed by the recognition of the profession. We will also use this phase to implement a so-called open innovation process, defining ideal strategies, processes, and distribution channels for the rollout of the business model. This means we will include different stakeholder groups, especially, of course, our potential future clients. We will have workshops with them and so on. The next training course is, of course, based on the progress of this study, since it's linked to the legal status. And our goal is to complete 3 to 4 courses in this period. And we also intend to cooperate with new training partners in other federal states in order to attract women from all over Austria. Of course, we also plan to fully roll out the business model and earn money on the free market. But we will still have to apply for additional funding. And one thing that really shows me that we are on the right path right now is that there are already some companies interested in participating in our study, partnering with us, and thus helping us to finance this stage. So summing up, what are our learnings so far? Let's start with the biggest challenges. One is for sure adapting to the given legal status and the restrictions we face. And therefore, it's important to understand the local healthcare system and the financial structure. Then it's about identifying, I call it always, our friends and our foes, meaning who are our supporters and who are people that have doubts, who are people that might see us as game changers. And game changers, you know, it's often something that can be interpreted as threats. And such doubts might be overcome by identifying ideal positioning, progress, and channels within the given system, which leaves no one behind. Another challenge is bridging the financial gap. It's very hard to predict at the moment how long it will take us until the legal status will be changed accordingly. On the other hand, there is a lot of things that work really well. This is the collaboration with philanthropists, especially during the evaluation phase. Also the collaboration with public authorities in the field of labor market integration. We have already established a great network of supporters and ambassadors. And furthermore, there is a high demand from companies who would like to provide tactile examinations to their employees. And last but not least, well, there is the story. Our value proposition is very clear and easy to tell, and therefore, example, the media, and especially the women in Austria, our future clients, are very much interested in discovering hands. And I'd like to conclude with some numbers that are very encouraging. This is the feedback from 100 women in Austria who have already experienced the tactile examination. We first asked them if they enjoyed the examinations, and more than 9 out of 10 said yes. And we wanted to know if they would get the examination done again. Almost everybody confirmed that they would do so. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the most powerful message and the strong motivation for us. And this is why we are convinced, or if I missed something, and this is the most important point of my presentation. You know? But as I said, it's the most powerful message, and the motivation is very strong. And this is why we are convinced that we will also manage to overcome the obstacles. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Now I want to say something about Specialisterne Austria and our challenges and what works. And I want to start with a short video. So, how did we start in Austria? Is there a market in Austria for working with people with autism? Yes, there is. 1% of the population have autism all over the world, so also in Austria, and the talents of people with autism are very useful to companies, of course, also in Austria. So, in the startup phase, we got private funding of the Essl Foundation, so we could start up to make a research which companies are interested to meet people with autism and institutions and, of course, public funding institutions like the unemployment office. different than in Denmark, it was not possible to get public funding in the first period. So we could only start because of the Essl Foundation. We employed the first person with autism in a leasing model because the enterprise did not have a headcount. So slowly, slowly, we found out that the leasing model is working better and easier than in other countries where the companies are employing people with autism directly. It was quite interesting for us. What is essential about working with people with autism that they have to feel in a comfort zone, and we have to find out the talents and the working environment in which they want to work and can unfold their talent in the best way and can shine as a dandelion. So in other countries, they have a 5 months of training or assessment to get to know the people. We did not have this possibility in Austria for 2 years. The second phase, we got public funding, we could do this assessment of 5 months, and it helped us to know a lot of people in a good way, and we could hire a lot of people with autism. The challenges were that then the public funding ended, and we started a module system. So we had not like 25 hours a week for everybody for 5 months. We just could do workshops, IT trainings, and we still do that now like this. It works, but of course we can only work with people with a light form of autism. We are it's not possible in Austria that we work with people who are who need more time. That's a pity, but it's how it is. What is a challenge is that in Austria there is no educational program for people with autism. It's difficult to study because the universities are very chaotic for them and overcrowded. Schools are not specialized, and there's nothing for people with autism. Nobody is specialized in this field. And we can't work with the big companies of Thorkil SONNE, the SAP or HP. They don't develop software in Austria, they just sell. So for us, we could not refer to these international clients. We had to build up our own company relationships. What works? Here you see the companies we are working with. Some hired one person, and after a time, the second or the third. Shire employs 5 people in quality insurance or programming. So we have long-term relationships with the corporations. We do network events with them. We have, I think, a very strong relationship with our companies, even though there is no company saying, okay, we take 10 on one time. So it's a very, very slowly process. It is hard work to build up the relationship with the corporations, but we have long-term contracts. We provide long-term coaching so that the people with autism have a career and can develop themselves. And you see on the slide the talents needed by the companies. What is working also very well is the workshops for managers and the team. We speak open about autism, about the strengths and the needs, and we encourage the whole team, where the person with autism starts to work, that also the team is speaking about their needs and their challenges. So it's like equal rights, and yeah, everybody has needs, and the team develop in an emotional way, and the work of the people with autism is very, it's in a very good quality. Now I want to give a word for one or two minutes to Amade, what works good. We have here a colleague with autism. He was one of the first we employed by leasing, and now he is employed by the enterprise directly. Amade, bitte.
My name is Amade Modos. I live here in Vienna. I'm almost 45 years old, and it was 4 years ago that I got my my diagnosis of Asperger autism. So it was very late compared to my whole life. And what was before? I always knew that I'm different from other people, but I couldn't say what it was. I studied insurance mathematics. Afterwards, I worked for 10 years in this insurance area, we can say, but I had not very much success. It was difficult for me. Afterwards, there was a period of about 3 years without any job, but fortunately then I got my diagnosis, and immediately afterwards I looked for a possibility to return to the job market, and very soon I found Specialisterne Austria, and with Elisabeth KRÖN there, and not very much after I got more and more works, and now I have been working for 3 years in a company which edits books with jurisdictional content, and there I make very, very simple works, but it's very good for me. It's a work worth going, which I don't need this high degree of flexibility. It's very systematic. I order things, I compare things, and so on. And everybody in that enterprise respects my autism, and they are very nice to me. They carry only works which fit me. So I'm very content with it. And yeah, thank you once again to Specialisterne. And besides, I am that one who was mentioned by Thorkil with the book. It's here's once again the book that I have written in German about my life. Is the title for it can be translated to English as "I need to get forward in my life as in the darkness where I much find the way with my hands," so in this way. So I wrote it down. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Ana Botero, and I work for CAF, Banco de Desarrollo de América Latina, Bank of Latin America of Development. We are a bank committed to promote sustainable development and regional integration in Latin America. We have 19 member governments, and I am the head of the Office of Social Innovation. And my office works as a laboratory, that tests and finances models, dynamics, ideas that have the potential to become useful and sustainable solutions to social problems in the region, particularly of those most vulnerable. We are at my office, we do not pretend to be, and we might not be innovators ourselves, but we certainly have at the bank, being a multilateral bank, we have the muscle to act as enablers of social innovation in the alleviation of poverty and in the promotion of sustainable development. And this is due basically to the strengths that we have in CAF. so that you know a little bit about the bank. You're probably most familiar with the World Bank and with the IDB, but CAF is as important as the other multilaterals. We, first of all, our regional standing and our knowledge about the region. Second, because we have the power or the capability to finance and to mobilize resources, financial resources and knowledge. Third, as governments are the owners of the bank, we have an important power or an important muscle to influence in public policies. And last but not least, especially for social innovation, is extremely important our capability to connect actors from different sectors and disciplines so that they can come together and create a collective impact. Today we were talking, this morning somebody was mentioning about the importance of partnership. So we do cultivate and we really work on partnerships in order to create collective impact. Our work at our office, we can't see much, you know? We work at two levels in permanent synergy in our Office of Social Innovation. One level is sort of what I call the macro level, in which we forge partnerships with global actors in order to promote changes or to promote tendencies of change in the world. You might be familiar with the big corporations movement. It is extremely important in the American hemisphere now. We are promoting new ways of measuring social impact. This morning somebody was saying, and I totally agree with her, that sometimes you don't have to measure. There are certain things that one doesn't measure. We are trying to open the debate to incorporate the invisibles of development, incorporating empowerment, agency, going about in life without shame and humiliation and so on, and going beyond the traditional measures of income and basic aspects of health and education. And also at that level, we try to participate actively in networking. For example, Ashoka that was recently mentioned, in order to identify social innovation and to capture knowledge. But it is really at the micro level that is probably more relevant to this conference, in which we really roll up our sleeves and work as a laboratory, enhancing capabilities, strengthening capabilities of vulnerable groups in order to promote opportunities for inclusion, either through productive work or either through providing access to basic services. Among these groups are youngsters at risk. You probably know in Latin America we have about 20 million ninis, ni en el colegio, ni en el trabajo, no work and no school. And that is an extremely, a very serious problem because they are the future generation for the region. We work with inmates. We are now working with people with disabilities, and that is why this brings me to this conference, which I am very grateful for the invitation. More than words, I think that an example is much more illustrative. So I'd like to share with you one video in which this is the first adaptation of Discovering Hands in a developing country outside the European context and also in another language different from German. So this is a unique example and very powerful example of what social innovation is and what we are doing back in Bogota. I'm based in Bogota in our office. So if we can share the video with the audience and afterwards we could look at some of the factors that have led to the successful implementation of Discovering Hands in Colombia. We want this Colombian example to become the showcase for the rest of Latin America. I don't know whether he's going to show the video.
Para mí el sentido del tacto desde que adquirí la discapacidad.
nos convoca un muy feliz acontecimiento. La ceremonia.
Just a few minutes to conclude, but as I told you, I mean this is social innovation is about a powerful idea, an innovative idea, and I think that we got it here, and a powerful idea to alleviate poverty in Latin America, targeting two very important problems, as Frank said before, salud pública, a public health problem, as we saw there, it's the cancer that kills most women in Latin America, and also the possibility of giving a job opportunity to people that are normally excluded from the labor market. We have an embarrassing rate of 90% of unemployed in this group of people. But also the strengthening of invisible capabilities. I do emphasize very much in the issue of self-esteem, dignity, empowerment, and so on, because those capabilities are extremely important for other capabilities to flourish. The second point is the issue of mindset. And this is what Frank said before, looking, interpreting the reality, reinterpreting the reality in the sense of a perceived disability being transformed into a capability. These women in Cali, in the public transportation system, they call them doctores ángeles. And they call them the doctors with the manos mágicas, with the magical hands. So what you're seeing in the society, we were really surprised as how they were perceived in the hospitals, very admired, very respected, and so on. But only in, but also the people in the public transportation. They already knew them because we have them with. They have very nice uniforms and so on. So people identify them in Cali very easily. Something extremely important for us to have been successful is the ecosystem. And this morning, there was a lot of talk about partnerships. And here I have to stress the partnership hand in hand with the community, with the visually impaired women themselves. We have been working hand in hand with them, with the associations of blind people, with the hospital, the doctor that is on the video, and also extremely important, bringing the local public actor into the scene. At the very early stage, we invited the mayor and we invited several actors so that if we really want to scale, we start to start influencing public policy at the local level. As I said before, social innovation is about public value. Everybody wins. And this is not about capturing individual value, but everybody wins, patients, the society at large, the women, insurance companies, the medical doctors, obviously the MTEs, the examiners, and so on. We have been documenting every stage of the process, because if we really want to scale up and other actors to learn from us, we need to systematize and to have all the lessons learned very well registered. And we have been measuring with a clinical study that has been also the preliminary results are showing that 80 women out of 100 cases, 80 cases have been diagnosed positively by the MTEs, finding the malformations, as opposed to the medical doctors that have only been able to detect 50 cases out of those 100 cases. We have completed the training. These women, we started in January, are already incorporated into 5 public hospitals in Colombia, and one of them has left to Mexico and is working in Mexico at a private consultancy with a medical doctor. We are about to start replicating in Mexico and most possibly in the near future in Spain with Fundación Once, who should be here or in the room next door. So I just wanted to share this experience with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna. Thank you, everybody on the panel, for your concise presentations, for your clear and open language, also mentioning all the problems that are related to. Unfortunately, we are running over time, so I can't. Sorry? Yeah, well, we have to ask it later. Sorry, we are on overtime. So there were a lot of excellent examples. Thank you also, Amadeh, for your great intervention. Congratulations to your book. The bad news is we can't answer any questions here on the podium. And let's say farewell to the panel with a warm applause. Thank you.